good I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me. So today, let's look at the roles and responsibilities in the family. I want you to know that the first role, I believe, a very critical role that God plays is that he is the initiator of the family. And all of us who are in the family must remember that God as initiator has the right of ownership over the family. We don't own the copyrights for family. We cannot run the family the way we want. We need licenses to run the family. That's why if you have a computer and you want to use a Microsoft Word, you've got to buy the license. And that the family of God is a spiritual picture of the family of men. And the family of men is the natural picture of the family of God. So this principle applies also, I believe, in the family of men. And so you find that Apostle Paul, you know, he's talking about praying for the believers and he's saying some stuff. And then when he begins to describe the God that he's praying to, and he says, this God is the one from whom the whole family in heaven and on earth is named. When you name a whole family, it means this is like, God is like the hub. He is like, you know, you see in a wheel, there is a wheel and then there is a hub. And then all the spokes join there. Everybody's joined there. So God unifies us. Families are named after God. And without God, we don't have that kind of unification. We can strengthen this. We know another, you know, few scriptures, 1 Corinthians 8, 5 to 7. And here he was, Apostle Paul was trying to demean some gods that were being worshipped and wanted to distinguish, you know, God the Father from them. And he says, for even if there are so-called gods, whether in heaven or on earth, and then in parenthesis, he says, yes, there are many gods and many lords, yet for us, there is one God, the Father, of whom all things, and we for him, and one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom all things and through whom we live. That's a lot of stuff right there. But all he's saying is that God is the center. He is the one that holds the center of everything. You remove God, everything falls apart. And again, I tell you, look at any family, whether the church family. If a church begins to do stuff and God is left out, we start focusing on, you know, the work and the developments and the things we do, and, you know, and we forget God. We start just building a name for ourselves. We become good at branding and God never features anywhere. Eventually, things fall apart because the moment he stops holding things together, because he is the unifier, then things will go wrong. When you come to the grassroots family level, God left out, and people begin to live the way they want, a family begins to disintegrate. The man wakes up in the morning on Sunday, instead of herding the family to come to church, he is thinking of where he's going to wash his car and read the newspaper. And the mother, her nails are not done. The kids, if you are not going to church, mom and dad, we are also not going. And before you know it, people are not worshiping God. People are, and I'm not saying that people can only worship God when they are coming to church. But let me tell you, if there is no formal way of expressing our faith to God, it fails. We naturally as human beings need some sort of formalization and institutionalization of things. Things left on their own, they don't just work out. And that's why I urge you, parents, be careful how you behave. When you wake up in the morning and you do not show children that it's important for them to prepare to go to the service, to worship God, they grow up not thinking this is important. And they grow up, they become apathetic. So if you are struggling with it, they will struggle more and your great-grandchildren will never go to church and you have lost it. Because there's something about unification. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 4 to 6, the Bible says, this is talking about, of course, the church of Jesus Christ. There is one body and one spirit, just as you are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. One God and a Father of all. One God and Father of all. Okay? Who is above all, through all, and in you all. When Apostle Paul, remember, talks these things, he's not just talking to a vacuum. He's talking to people who are in families. So the family is included. Because many times what tends to happen when we read the word of God, we tend to remove the context of our lives. And the reason why God's word becomes ineffective in our lives is we never contextualize it where it matters most. So when we read scripture, we only leave it at the church level. But we forget that when he says one and all in all, he's also talking about you, not only when you are seated in the service, but when you are seated in your home with your family. Everybody say unifier. God is the one that unifies us. And if you want to see a family that is struggling, look at a family that has ignored God. Because once you ignore God, first of all, you ignore him as an initiator, so you don't think he has a right to say anything about your family. Number two, you forget him as a unifier. And no wonder things can't hold together. You can't agree with your spouse. You can't do anything together. The children are going, when you are going east, they are going west. There is no alignment. Unifier. Row number three, and the last one, and I really love this one. God is the benchmark of fatherhood. I loved that one. He's a benchmark of fatherhood. In other words, everybody seeking to be a father must establish their benchmark. And I'll tell you what a benchmark is with God. The standard. In fact, I believe God is not simply a benchmark of fatherhood, but even for motherhood. Because there are sometimes in scripture that God refers to himself as a mother. It's amazing. Because he's not gender him, he's a role. A benchmark is a standard or point of reference against which things may be either compared or measured. That's a simple definition of a benchmark. People who do surveys, especially topographical surveys, topography is just the way the ground either flattens or slopes. For you to determine the gradient of a slope, you must determine where you're going to measure from. Say you want to measure my heart right now, my height. Okay? The benchmark for measuring my heart is my height is where I'm standing, not here. Because if you measure me from here, I'll be taller than I am. That's why we say this place is so many meters above sea level. In other words, we are measuring the height of Mutwini with the sea level. The measurement from the sea level, and then now as you measure, you know that we are either 3,000 feet or meters or whatever they are above the sea level. So when we think about God, then God becomes our benchmark of fatherhood. In other words, he's the standard or point of reference against which we measure the quality of our fathering. So if you think you're a good father, don't measure yourself against your neighbor who you think that's a poor standard. Oh, you know, my neighbor, you know, beats my wife every night. Me, I only do it once. That's a poor standard. God, playing his role in the family, becomes the benchmark of fatherhood. And that's why I want to challenge every father who is here. Use God as your benchmark, standard for your fatherhood. Not your father, not your own father. Some of our fathers tried very much, but they were not good fathers. And we give it up to them because they didn't have some of the privilege we have. We have a lot of information. We have a lot of exposure. Most of you have grown up in church. Some of our parents really tried hard. God just helped them. It's a miracle that we turned out the way we did. I'm telling you, it's just, so don't blame them. But you now, you have exposure. Some of you have sat in this church a whole year listening about, you know, the magnificence of family. You can't compare yourself with your father who never had anywhere close to what I've said. In Psalm 103, verse 13, this is one of the ways that God behaves as a father. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. Of course, the psalmist is using the natural father to show us how the spiritual father behaves. But in this same verse, we see that there is an acknowledgement of a father who pities. So God has pity. That's just one of the examples. The best example of a father is Luke chapter 11, verse 11. I want us to read together before, because we are just about to conclude the sermon. Shall we read? One, two, read. If a son asks for bread from any father among you, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent instead of a fish? Okay. Shall we move on? Okay. Verse 13. Or if he asks for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? Okay. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? So again, Jesus is teaching a lesson. And of course, here we are seeing just much more than what he's teaching. He gives us a picture of our heavenly Father. And here he is addressing us as earthly fathers. But then he draws a parallel and shows us that as much as we are evil and we do the things we do, our Father, who is not evil, is way, way better. And he will do even exceedingly abundantly what we ask or even think about. But the basic message that I'm passing to you here today is that God is the benchmark for family. God is a standard of reference against which fatherhood is to be compared. And so you begin to see why it is very important for anybody, when they get into the way of family, to consider the role of God in the family. First of all, as the initiator. When you know that God is the initiator, you will not just, you know, deal with family casually. When you know God is a unifier, you pay attention to him. And when you know that God is a benchmark of fatherhood, you raise your standard of measuring your own fatherhood. Some of us think we are good fathers because we use a very poor standard. We use our friends. But they are not the standard. Remember, if you use a wrong standard, you can never achieve the correct position. I told you, if I measure my height, and instead of me being measured from where I'm standing, where my feet touches this podium or this floor, somebody measures from the floor here, my height will be exaggerated. So no wonder some of us have exaggerated ideas of who we are in the family. You think you're a good father, you think you're a good mother, but you're doing so badly because you're using the wrong standard. Have you ever seen a child who comes from a school, they are scoring, they are number one, okay? Then they go to another school and they are last. You know what the problem is? The standard. I schooled in our village school, and I did my case, those days it was KCE. No. Is it KCE? CPE. I did my CPE in 1980. I scored 32 points out of 36. Of course, that was a shocker because I was expecting to score 36. Okay? It's true. I topped my class from class one. If I was not top, it was either my twin brother or another cousin of mine. We used to sit on the same desk. I went to a national school. So when we go to Isiolo, my father, you know, was thinking I was a very good student. So he began to talk to some kids who were waiting with their parents there. The first one he went to, 36 points. The second one, 35. The other one, 36. He came and told me, Stanley, these kids are better than you. Okay? He just told me, let me tell you, you have to work very hard because you are going to be in the midst of sharks. And sure enough, term one, we did. I was thinking I'm going to top the class like I've always done in my village school. I was number 7. I was depressed. Number 7. That has never happened in my life. I went home, he told me, young man, no, we can't accept this. I went, tried again, number 5. And that was hard. And then eventually I pushed it back to number 2 and number 1. Now, you are not believing me. Can I bring my certificates? I mean, you guys, honestly, you don't think I'm a smart brain. You don't think so. You know, I see the shock in your faces. I thought even the way I preach sounds smart, isn't it? Now, anyway, on a light note. Now, I went all that way not really to tell you that. All I'm telling you is if you use the wrong standard, you will have a false impression of who you are. That's what I'm saying. So let's go back to the benchmark. So what are the responsibilities of God in the family? Number 1 is the? Number 2? And number 3? As we conclude, I want to tell you 3 things. Number 1, let God be the owner of your family. Let God be the owner of your family. Why owner? Because if he is the initiator, he owns rights. Now I know that is a very huge statement that needs to be unpacked. But when somebody else owns something that you are managing, you treat it differently. You are a steward. So that every time you look at your wife, your children, when you look at your husband and children, it reminds you that this is not mine. I'm just being given a responsibility to manage. This family belongs to somebody else. This is God's idea. I've just been licensed to use it. I can't change the configuration. Because some of us have changed the configuration of God's family. It's like Microsoft selling you a license and you edit it. It's illegal. And that's what we have done with family. Many of us have edited the family configuration. Wives are no longer wives. Husbands are no longer husbands. Number 2, allow God to hold your family together. Don't use unqualified methods. You've heard of people who give up, and instead of praying and asking God to hold their family together, they start using other means, manipulative gimmicks. In extreme cases, we even have Christians going to talk to witch doctors to hold the family together. Can't be held together. Nobody else has the capacity to hold your family together. Let me tell you, when God is in the midst of your family, he is able to consolidate, bring you together, provided you have allowed him to be the owner of your family. When he tells you something, you will do it. And that's how the unity comes in. If I'm big-headed and God speaks to me about my wife and things I need to do, then I'll listen to God and we'll be together. What would separate us? God will deal with it. Let God hold your family together. That's why everybody in your family must know that God is central in your family. You will hold together. And finally, let God be your perfect example of fatherhood. Let God be your perfect example of fatherhood. This is especially to men, because fatherhood is key. Today we are talking about God. When we talk about the Holy Spirit, probably the point for the ladies here will be, let the Holy Spirit be a perfect example of what kind of a helper you are supposed to be. Because the Holy Spirit, like the wife, is a helper. Let God be your perfect example of fatherhood. So that as a man, when you think about your fatherhood, you are not thinking about your friends, and then you compare yourself with the way they behave. This is a very simple sermon, but I believe it has very practical handles that we can use to ensure that we build a magnificent family.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still